gathered together because of our love for Marjorie Deline. I, Douglas, her husband, knew Marge, and I know that she drew comfort and healing from readings from two books, the Bible and Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures by Mary Baker Eddy. These two books form the basis of worship in our religion, which was Christian Science. I will now read from the Bible and Science and Health. Psalms. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Isaiah. Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, Fear not, I will help thee. John. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. 2 Thessalonians. Now our Lord Jesus Christ himself, and God, even our Father, which hath loved us, and hath given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts, and establish you in every good word and work. Proverbs. Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household. Her children arise up and call her blessed. Her husband also. And he praiseth her. Psalms. Mark the perfect man, and behold the upright. For the end of that man is peace. God is infinite. The only life, substance, spirit, or soul. The only intelligence of the universe, including man. If life were in mortal man or material things, it would be subject to their limitations and would end in death. God is spirit. Therefore, in spirit all is harmony. And there can be no discord. All is life, and there is no death. Everything in God's universe expresses Him. Physical sense defines mortal man as based on matter, and from this premise infers the mortality of the body. As a material, theoretical life basis is found to be a misapprehension of existence. The spiritual and divine principle of man dawns upon human thought. The infinite never began, nor will it ever end. Life and its faculties are not measured by calendars. The perfect and immortal are the eternal likeness of their maker. Man, governed by immortal mind, is always beautiful and grand. Life is eternal. Life and goodness are immortal. Let us then shape our views of existence into loveliness, freshness, and continuity, rather than into age and blight. Beauty as well as truth is eternal. But the beauty of material things passes away, fading and fleeting as mortal belief. Immortal men and women are models of spiritual sense, drawn by perfect mind and reflecting those higher conceptions of loveliness which transcend all material sense. Life is, always has been, and ever will be independent of matter. For life is God, and man is the idea of God. Not formed materially, but spiritually, and not subject to decay and dust. Life is not in matter. Therefore, it cannot be said to pass out of matter. Matter and death are mortal illusions. Spirit and all things spiritual are the real and eternal. Life is the everlasting I am, the being who was and is and shall be, whom nothing can erase. God and the real man are inseparable as divine principle and idea. God is the principle of man, and man is the idea of God. Hence, man is not mortal nor material. The calm, strong currents of true spirituality, the manifestations of which are health, purity, and self-immolation, must deepen human experience until the beliefs of material existence are seen to be a bald imposition, and sin, disease, and death give everlasting place to the scientific demonstration of divine spirit and to God's spiritual, perfect man. I would like to now play a recording by our good friend Jennifer Brenneman, singing the solo, Mark the Perfect Man. This solo was a particular favorite of Margie's. In fact, she specifically asked Andrea and myself, as we sat by her bedside on Independence Day, the day before she passed, that this be played at her service.
Wherein is he to be accounted of?
Well, where do you begin? President John F. Kennedy once stated that he was honored to be known as the man who accompanied Mrs. Kennedy to Paris. Her charm, grace, and lovely demeanor captivated the French public and reflected well on him. In like manner, I am honored to have been the man who accompanied Marjorie Deline to Paris, Istanbul, Oslo, Tokyo, Havana, Beijing, and dozens of other locales. Together, we visited 6 of the 7 continents of the world and shared wonderful memories of people and places and times. I'm sure we would have also visited Antarctica had Marge located a functioning tango salon or club on that continent. One of her criteria for visiting a city was whether we would be able to attend a milonga, that's a tango dance party, while there. And I have lasting memories of dancing with her in a huge outdoor square in Xi'an in western China, one evening under the moonlight, in an area about 1/4 mile on each side. Thousands of Chinese men and women and one lone Western couple danced waltz and swing and, of course, tango and a dozen other steps, each in a designated area of the square around small portable sound systems for each dance. There was also a light show, street vendors, and entertainers. This event happened weekly. And nearly the whole city seemed to be present. We were welcomed with open arms, even though we couldn't understand a word of Chinese. and everyone enjoyed the peace and serenity of that evening. I also should note that I didn't see any police presence at all anywhere in that square that night. None of this would have happened if I hadn't known Marge. In our household, one person successfully defended an accused in a criminal trial in Midland County Circuit Court. And it wasn't me. The facts were these. Marge used to conduct courthouse tours for fifth graders as part of Midland County Lawyers Auxiliary. Throughout the year, busloads of children would arrive at the courthouse, and one of several volunteers would guide them, pointing out the important areas and the history of the building, culminating in a mock trial, conducted entirely according to made-up, unscripted lines by the children, acting as judge, prosecutor, jury, and of course, the accused. One winter day, she arrived for an early tour group, and due to an overnight snowfall, parked across Main Street from the courthouse in an unfamiliar parking lot of what was then the Strohsacker's office building. Due to the snow, the handicap parking sign on the pavement was not visible, and she happened to overlook the small, discreet brown handicap sign about 20 feet away on the side of the building, which I should add had a brown brick exterior, nearly the same color as the sign. As you might guess, a diligent officer of the law issued a citation for illegally parking in a handicapped parking spot. In due course, Marge, who was determined to fight this miscarriage of justice, appeared before the Honorable Paul Clulo to defend her actions. She represented herself, or pro se, as it's called. I couldn't attend the hearing, but I had coached her to include in her comments the lack of adequate notice and its central importance to the issue of due process. I'm not sure if she used that at all in her talks. But probably more dispositive was the fact that over the past 10 years or so, she had appeared on numerous occasions in Judge Clulo's courtroom with 30 or more noisy fifth graders who sat for a 10-minute lecture from the judge about what went on in that room. The result was a resounding victory with dismissal of all charges due to lack of adequate notice. The prosecutor never knew what hit him. As a direct result of this seminal case, if you happen someday to be in the parking lot of the brown brick building downtown Midland, across Main Street from the courthouse, notice the handicapped parking signs on the building's exterior. They now are a contrasting blue color, not at all in keeping with the original intent of the architect's color scheme. Marge has left her impact on Midland. Marge also affected our city in other ways. If you have enjoyed a concert or play at the renovated Central Auditorium, you can thank the efforts of Marge and her co-chair of the Central Auditorium Restoration Committee, Pam Buchholz, for their efforts to conserve and restore that building. I will now yield the floor to my son Chris and then Andrea, who would like to share some of their memories of their mother. After which, if anyone else would like to share a special moment or remembrance, you may feel free to do so. In order to appear on the video, however, and to provide the best sound for those viewing on the internet, please come up to the podium and use this microphone. At the end of this comments and remembrances, I will be reading a poem which Marge also very much enjoyed.
So we're all here to celebrate the impact that Marge had on the community and the whole world. It was substantial. She didn't go meekly through life. She was an active participant, a director of it. If Marge was in the room, you knew it. as remarkable as a woman she was, she was always just mom to me. I thought it was normal. It's just this is what moms do. You know, she was a great involved mother. You know, maybe the first helicopter parent. She kept us so busy, you know, going to swim team, dance lessons, ice skating, tennis, piano, tap dancing. At the time, I probably wasn't as appreciative of all the efforts that she put into it and for the family. I felt sometimes like I was just being dragged along in her wake. But now I do appreciate all that she did for us kids and the family, exposed to all the travel opportunities, all the enriching art, and all the music and all the other opportunities, and her energy and attention. She was a great grandmother too to my two sons, and a good mother-in-law to my wife. Once she figured out that my wife also has opinions. But we'll remember our beach visits in Florida. We had a magical time at Universal Studios, especially both boys were into Harry Potter. And so we had many fond memories of that. In Michigan, we have also made great memories picking blueberries, catching fireflies, campouts in the backyard, shucking peas for dinner, making corn and biscuits. So she was a very brave and self-assured woman too, with moral courage and strength of convictions. And she was a planner too and a director. Boy, did she love deals. Anytime we were coming to visit, she was always finding the cheapest flights, the best deals. Even if they came in at midnight, you know, she just wanted to find those great deals. She loved to facilitate that for everybody. Even in her last days, she was an organizer, helping to identify photos of long ago relatives. And she was brave too, making the call herself to go on hospice at the end. Her bravery also extended to a love of travel. So I remember family vacations, driving across the country. If there was a museum in town, boy, we were right there. We had to stop at every museum. Had to be educational, not just fun. And perhaps we ended up at some of your doorsteps too, coming across the country, because she loved to combine travel with visiting with friends and relatives and making connections across country. Even overseas, I remember rolling up at distant cousins in England that I'd never heard of before, but they still put us up for the night. And in Germany, she found people that she was related to. She had some exotic travel destinations that Doug mentioned, some with us kids and some without, in Turkey, Israel, Australia. One memorable adventure that we had, family was spending Christmas in Jamaica. It was eye-opening. We weren't secluded at some all-inclusive resort. We were in the thick of it in a third world country. I'm sure she found a good deal on a hotel downtown. So we were there with the hawkers and beggars and street artists. And I remember a kid no older than my oldest, maybe 11 or 12, walked up to Marge here in Jamaica and asked her if she wanted to buy a joint. As a teenager, I thought that was so hilarious. It's totally not something she was about. She politely declined. Part of me wishes she had said yes, though. So I mentioned going through photos of relatives, and that was something else important to her, family. She came from a small family herself, as an only child with no cousins. So I feel like she was really welcomed by, you know, the Deline side of the family and the Starks as well. I feel like she adopted you all, or vice versa. And she was really interested in genealogy. She treated it like a detective puzzle, going back and trying to piece together who was related to whom. And she would always send out we'd find out about it if she found some sixth generation back stepbrother or something like that. She would treat it like a small victory. And I loved that at Thanksgiving, you know, she would come and come together with the whole family and include us and the boys as well. And I feel like that was such a tight connection coming back for Thanksgiving. And all the research that she did on genealogy put her in touch, and it made it so tangible, just all the connections in the family that we shared together. I like to think it's like a web extending backwards through time. And if you go back far enough, if you think about it, all of us are connected. It just touches all of us. And I think she really felt that too, that wider sense of community and wanting to heal the world. I remember, you know, she would be at school reading with our class, tutoring some of the other readers. She wanted to give back to her family and community. I was proud when she was on the board of the Central Auditorium Project and on the board of the Asher Foundation to support Christian Science education. It was great that she could put her energy and talents into that. She was always busy with something. If it wasn't church or volunteering, it was working with us kids or grandkids, or even putting together a winning NCAA basketball bracket, or practicing her tango partner work. So to close, I want to say that this is my first experience of such a close loved one passing. There were aspects of it that were unexpected. I cherish the last few days that I had with her, like playing piano hymns for her. I wanted every minute that I still had with her to stretch on forever. I just wanted so much to be living in a world where she was still part of it. She was so loving and so loved. She was just on a pedestal for me, a role model to follow. And although she's gone, part of her still lives on through me, through our family, all the other lives that she's touched. Through that web of connection, it stretches backwards and it stretches forward through time to where she is right now in infinity. I love you forever.
Great. Well, those were two pretty tough acts to follow. I don't know if I'm going to be quite as eloquent of a speaker. My mom obviously passed on the love of the arts to me, so I became a dancer, and part of dance is being absolutely silent and not talking at all. So I did get Marge's gift of the gab, but public speaking is definitely not my strong point, so I'll try to do my best to get through without tearing up, but I just wanted to put some together, some sentiments and thoughts that I had. I thought about my mom, and there's just so much, you know, to think about and talk about, and my brother touched on so many great moments and thoughts, and a lot of, you know, ditto everything you just said, I would say too, you know, just all the activities and things that we did together as a family and all of the crazy escapades and detailed plans and thorough planning. I just, even planning some of the things for today, I wish that she had been here to help. And, you know, she was, in a way. She had planned, you know, obviously her own song. She had helped me organize photos decades ago. And, you know, she lives on through the two of us and echoes through infinity, through all of the teachings that she gave us and all of the love that she shared with us and all of you as well. So hard to put together thoughts to explain what I think of my mother. She was an extraordinary person who lived a life with passion and joy. She's blessed with wisdom beyond her years, a calm and soothing presence, and a deep appreciation for beauty, nature, wisdom, science, the arts, and especially spreading love and kindness to all she came in contact with. Every day that passes, since she's been gone, it has dawned on me more and more clearly what an incredible woman she was. As my brother said, she was just mom, you know? It just didn't seem like, you know, it seemed very normal to have a person who was so extraordinary taking care of us and teaching us how to live in this world. Every day, I realize how much I relied on her for her sound advice and calming words of comfort. Anytime I felt distress or like I couldn't manage something, she was always there for me to kind of lend a listening ear and give me the best advice that I hadn't thought of before. She was always so good at reasoning through something and figuring out the best solution and the best logical way. She was a woman of logic, and I never realized how lucky I was to have such an amazing woman to call my mom. She taught me so many valuable lessons in the short time we had together. How to love deeply, how to always think of others before myself, and how to take time to plan several steps ahead, which is what I'm still working on. It's always the lesson that keeps on giving for me. That was one I didn't quite master yet, so hopefully someday I'll be as good as Marge was at that. And to never stop constantly keeping your words and your thoughts and your echoes through your life uplifted and positive. She was always such a kind person and was always willing to love others and spread her joy and her kindness to those perfect strangers, as well as her friends and family. She was also the glue that held our family together. She was constantly moving and shaking, making plans, as Chris explained, all of her need to find the best deal to get us there and get everybody there at some point, maybe overnight flights and all of that. But she loved to travel and got to see so much of the world with my dad. And I'm so glad that they got to really do all of that together and see so much. And, you know, I was always dragged along as a kid seeing all the museums and probably don't remember as much of it as she would have liked, but she had such a steel trap memory that she could explain it, everything that happened and everywhere we went and everyone we saw. And I just never had a brain like that. So I definitely, Dad and I were just talking, like, I wish Mom was here. We could ask her what happened to that thing we had or where did we go when we did this trip. But she was always so on top of it and so organized and did such a good job keeping all of us in tow and keeping all of us on task. She loved connecting with others, planning outings to enjoy live theater, arts, dancing she loved doing with my dad, connecting with friends, helping at church and other volunteer work. She was involved in every single little thing that we did and obviously was the original helicopter parent, as my brother said. But, you know, she just really had such a presence that she would bring with her and was definitely always active in everything. She's also there to listen when you needed to let off some steam, or she was always ready to chip in when anyone asked for help. She was always there. In honor of my mom, I want to read a poem entitled Love by Mary Baker Eddy. These are words to a hymn in the Christian Science Church that my parents raised me in. And during my last few days with my mom, I got to be with her. I came and stayed with my parents for the last few weeks, taking care of her, helping my dad, and just loving on her and giving back to her because she gave so much to all of us. And I was really struggling to find my way forward as we neared the end in my mom's final hours. And this poem just seemed to come to me. It was kind of a sudden spark of inspiration and an angel message. I hope it will leave you also with some sense of peace and comfort. Just as it came over me, as my beautiful and well-loved mother will always and forever be in God's loving care. Love by Mary Baker Eddy. Brood o'er us with thy sheltering wing, neath which our spirits blend, like brother birds that soar and sing and on the same branch bend. The arrow that doth wound the dove darts not from those who watch and love. If thou the bending reed wouldst break, by thought or word unkind, pray that his spirit you partake, who loved and healed mankind. Seek holy thoughts and heavenly strain that make men one in love remain. Learn, too, that wisdom's rod is given for faith, to kiss and know that greetings glorious from high heaven, whence joys supernal flow, come from that love divinely near, which chastens pride and earth-born fear. Through God, who gave that word of might, which swelled creation's lay, let there be light, and there was light. What chased the clouds away? 'Twas love, whose finger traced aloud a bow of promise on the cloud. Thou, to whose power our hope we give, free us from human strife. Fed by thy love, divine we live, for love alone is life. And life most sweet, as heart to heart, speak us kindly when we meet and part. I just want to thank you all for being here and for sharing your love and honoring the legacy of my mother, Marjorie Deline. Thank you.
I have a contribution, also a poem from a good friend of ours, by Kim Chouette. He writes, "Do they dance in heaven?" A smooth dancer named Marge included all she knew in love. Complaints were rather rare, always attuned to prayer. She and husband raised thoughtful kids who turned out quite fine. She was proud of her family. Isn't that communion of a kind? There's no need to pretend, a great friend of mine, encourager of my work, frequent guest, for 50 years or more, why should it end? Looking beyond the veil, we here, them there, a Native American once said, they walk on. Instead of walking, how about dancing on? Marge was a smooth dancer, still is. Of course, they dance in heaven. Thank you, Kim. Anybody else? I have one other anecdote that I will fill in with before we conclude. We all know that Al Gore invented the internet. But did you know that Marge invented email? It happened this way. In the middle 1970s, she worked as a systems analyst and computer processor, and she had a client in Detroit who sold solvents and other chemicals to the auto companies and paint companies and so forth. And they had a home office in London and sales offices in Detroit and elsewhere. And she wrote them a program to track their inventories and keep straight everything that they had to do between the various branches. The client was spending large amounts of money on international phone calls back and forth to London. So Marge showed them how you could simply leave a note inside of the inventory program that she had written for them. And all users of the program could see the note and respond back in kind. So you could write, "How's the weather over there?" Or, "OMG, did you see what Mary was wearing today?" This feature of the program became heavily used, and the client's phone bill for international calling shrank considerably. And there are a lot more. Okay, so I would like to conclude with a poem, and many of you have probably heard of "The Rose Still Grows Beyond the Wall." And it's been used by several card companies in sympathy cards. However, the version I am going to be reading is the original version of this poem by A.L. Frink, and it first appeared in the Christian Science Journal of June 1901. Near shady wall, a rose once grew, budded and blossomed in God's free light, watered and fed by morning dew, shedding its sweetness day and night. As it grew and blossomed, fair and tall, slowly rising to loftier height, it came to a crevice in the wall, through which there shone a beam of light. Onward it crept with added strength, with never a thought of fear or pride. It followed the light through the crevice's length and unfolded itself on the other side. The light, the dew, the broadening view were found the same as they were before, and it lost itself in beauties new, breathing its fragrance more and more. Shall claim of death cause us to grieve and make our courage faint or fail? Nay, let us faith and hope receive. The rose still grows beyond the wall, scattering fragrance far and wide, just as it did in days of yore, just as it did on the other side, just as it will forevermore. Thank you all for coming and for viewing the service today on the internet or in the future. There will be a luncheon served downstairs for anyone who would like to attend. And of course, there's lots of talk. Thank you for coming.